Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our service as we're continuing today our Art of War series. But before I jump into our title, I first need a little bit of your participation, and I'm going to give you an option. You have to vote for one of two options. I'm not giving a third because I know how it goes. So first option, would you rather choose to, if I said, hey, we're doing a show of some hypnosis today, to come up to the stage and be hypnotized, and I make you act like a farm animal, but you have no control over it, and you probably won't remember it? Or option two, would you rather come up if I say, come and volunteer, and I will tell you what to do, but you've got full control. You decide how you want to act it out. The third option would have been you don't come up to the stage, but everyone would have raised their hand. Okay, so option one is hypnotism. You're going to act like something that I'm going to tell you to do, but you don't get a say in it. Or option two is you act something out. It's your choice. You've got control over it. So who chooses option one, to be hypnotized? Okay, there's a couple of people who's like, I can't act. Like, just do whatever you want. Okay, who chooses option two? I'd rather act it out than have control. Okay, there's a couple undecided people. You guys are lame, but thank you for those who did participate. I appreciate it. Why do we, most of us, choose option two? Because we do not want to lose control. Think about cartoons and comic strips. Like in the oldest ones, you would see people with their little tinfoil hats, right? Like to protect us against mind control from the aliens or from some kind of government rays. Then more modern stuff came in, like The Matrix. You choose the blue pill or the red pill. Like you either live in this reality that the robots created and it all looks good, but you have no control. Or two, you live in a harsher reality, but at least you have control. And then we have newer movies and books about things like virtual reality, where people can't discern anymore, am I now in virtual reality or in real life? But all of these movies and these stories and books tell something to us about our need for being in control, of not losing control and someone else is manipulating me. We don't want to lose control of our minds. Because the mind is the control center of our body. So if I lose control of my mind, I also lose control of my body, of my being. And what is interesting, as we're talking in the series about war, the art of war, even in ancient and modern warfare, war was never simply throwing spears at each other or shooting arrows at each other or dropping bombs. There's always been some kind of intellectual and psychological thing involved. In old tribes, people would paint their faces and scream and play drums. And these days, we read all this stuff about false information that's being spread on social media about governments and about wars and things, right? So there's always been in war an attack by an enemy that's not just physical, but that is trying to change our minds. And we are busy with the series, The Art of War. If you missed it, you can catch up on podcasting platforms or on YouTube. But we dealt in the first week with this reality that Paul says there is a spiritual world around us that we cannot deny. And in this world, spiritual world, there is an enemy that is out seeking to destroy us. And then we started talking about the different ways, because God doesn't leave us defenseless. The Bible says he gives us armor. He gives us ways to defend ourselves. And that's what we've been talking about and what we are continuing in today. And our topic today is fight for your mind. Fight for your mind. Because we don't want to be manipulated or controlled by someone else. We don't want this intellectual, psychological games. We want to fight for our mind, because if our mind is clear, then our body can do what it's supposed to do as well. If you've got your Bibles, you can open to Ephesians 6. It's also going to be on the screen. Paul writes to the church in Ephesus in Ephesians 6, and he tells them first about this reality of the spiritual war, and then he tells them how they can protect themselves against spiritual war. And if you missed any of these items, as I said, as I'm going to read through them today, you can catch up on other platforms. We have literally talked through each piece of the armor of God, but today we're going to read through some of them that we've already spoken about and then get to the one we're talking about today. Verse 14. Stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all of this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. And now our one for today, take the helmet of salvation. So as Paul is writing about the helmet, he's thinking of the armor of a Roman soldier that would have been present in their cities and their towns. So he's probably thinking about this helmet that the Romans used to wear that was either made of leather or of brass. The eyes were open, the mouth were open so that you could still see, so that you could still communicate. But the top of your head, the sides, the back were all protected. Your blind spots were protected from attacks of an enemy that would come at you from the side or from the back. And it is interesting that we understand the value even today of protecting our heads, and not just in warfare. But we understand it even in other practical things. I have been in a couple of accidents in my life, including a motorcycle accident and including a bicycle accident. And with the motorcycle, I always used to wear my helmet. With the bicycle, I was young and I was kind of like, you know, you're invincible when you're in your early 20s. Like, I don't need a helmet. So one day, I'm cycling back from university. It's a downhill. I'm going fast, like 37 or something. And this lady pulls out of her driveway, like right in front of me. So I hit the front of her car and I fly over the car. And if you've ever been in an accident, these things tend to happen in slow motion. It's so weird. Like, you see everything in slow motion. So there I am, like, doing the somersault over the car. And I see, like, my sunglasses going like... And they say your life flashes before your eyes, right? Here's the thing, the only thing I thought in that moment. I'm not kidding you. My mom was right. I should have worn my helmet. I'm literally like heading for a tree, and that is the only thing. My life didn't flash. I'm like, mom was right. Where's my helmet? So since that day, I wear my helmet on my bicycle as well. So if you see someone with a black helmet with a little red light, that's me. So be nice with the cyclists. But it's interesting. You get all kinds of gear, both for cycling and for motorbikes. You get boots and pants and jackets that protect you if you fall. But the only requirement, according to the law, is a helmet. It's to protect your head. Because our brain is one of our most vital organs. And if your brain is injured, there is a very high likelihood that it could cause your death. And the same in our spiritual lives. If a Christian's spiritual mind is injured, it could lead to spiritual death. And today, this is what we're going to be talking about. Because I think when we think of the attacks of the enemy, we often think of all of these kind of outside forces that could work on us, but we don't think about how it affects our minds, our control center, our command and control center of our beings. If Satan wants to control us, if our enemy that the Bible says who is out to destroy us, if he can control our minds, he can control our being. Thoughts have more influence on us than relationships or circumstances. Think about it for a moment. You can be in a hard situation, but if you think about it the right way, it doesn't sink you. You just think about how you overcome it, and it becomes a bridge to better leadership or to greater courage or greater faith. But if you think negatively about it, then suddenly you're feeling anxious and stressed out. Marriages go through ups and downs. And most people get through them, and you can get through them. But the moment you start thinking differently about your spouse, when you start thinking about a way out, you start thinking they will never change, that's the end. It starts in our thought world and not always in the physical. And this is the first thing I want you to know. If the enemy wants to ruin your life, he simply needs to ruin your mind. And then the spiritual battle, that's a reality that we are part of every day. The front line is between our ears. How does he want to ruin our lives? And I think there's three things that he tries to ruin through our mind. When Jesus had to summarize the entire law of God, He said two things are important. One is loving God with everything you have, and two is loving your neighbor as yourself. And the first thing I believe he wants to destroy is he's coming after your mind. He wants to ruin your life by ruining your horizontal relationships, your relationships with other people. If he can distort our thoughts and our emotions and our knowledge about other people, then our behavior will follow in the relationships and it will lead to the result he wants, broken relationships. In the Bible, in 2 Samuel, a book in the Old Testament, 2 Samuel 13, there's a story about one of King David, one of the greatest kings Israel ever had, of one of his sons, actually two of his sons. And his one son was called Amnon. And in Amnon's mind, a thing starts growing about his sister, his half-sister, Absalom's sister. He starts thinking about her in a way that is really not good. And it gets to the point where he finally pretends that he's sick so that she would bring him food, and he rapes his own half-sister. King David is supposed to do something, but he does nothing. So Absalom, for 2 years, something is growing in his mind about Amnon. And he's like, I'm going to figure out how to get him. And finally, what happens? Our thought leads to action. So finally, Absalom kills Amnon. And at the end of the day, this was probably the start of the thought process for Absalom that David cannot be king if he can't even handle things like this. And finally, Absalom overthrows his father, King David, and takes over his throne. It all started with evil thoughts in Amnon's mind that he allowed to grow. See, when we think ungodly things, our actions become ungodly. And the Bible actually warns us about this. James, the brother of Jesus, he wrote about this in James 1, verse 13 to 15. Hear what he writes. He says, remember, when you're being tempted, do not say, God is tempting me. God is never tempted to do wrong, and he never tempts anyone else. If there is a thought that pops up in your mind that is in contradiction to what God wants for your life, if there is a thought in your mind that destroys your relationships with your neighbors, the Bible says it's not from God. That's not who he is. That's not his character. So what does he say then? He says, verse 14, temptation comes from where? Our own desires. Our thought processes, which entice us and drag us away. It starts with a so-called innocent thought, but it starts dragging me down the wrong path. And then he says in verse 15, these desires then give birth to sinful actions. And when sin is allowed to grow, it gives birth to death. Guys, think about this for a moment. There is no fraud in the world that happens because somehow someone tripped, fell in under the table, and just found a bunch of money there. It started with a thought process of doing something wrong, of doing something evil, and figuring out how to get that money to someone to create, to do something fraudulent. There is no affair that happens because someone tripped and fell into someone else's bed. It starts with the thought process of lust after someone else that people that you might be working with, and then the actions follow the thoughts. Gossiping, name it. It's the same thing. It starts with our thoughts, and then James says it drags us away until finally it becomes our actions. The first relationship the devil wants to destroy is our horizontal relationships. Loving our neighbors. But he wants to destroy more than that. He wants to destroy your relationship with God. The devil wants you to lose control so you will sin. Why? Why? And let me first do this. Sin. What does sin mean? The Greek word amartia means to do something wrong, to sin. But it comes from the root, from the word, it's derived from hamartinein, which means to miss the mark. Literally, if you would shoot with a bow and an arrow at a target and you miss the target, that's what it means. You're missing the mark. So what sin means, if you take it back to the original form of the word, it means that it is something that is missing the mark of God, of what God intended for us. God intended one thing, and we're hitting a different target. So people often want me to describe, they want to know, like, is this wrong or is this right? I'm like, is it missing the mark that God had for your life? Is it destroying horizontal relationships or is it destroying your vertical relationship? Then it's sin, it's missing the mark. And why is this such a big deal? Leviticus 11, so in the Old Testament, hear what God says to the people. Verse 44, he says, I am the Lord your God, consecrate yourselves and be holy because I am holy. You see, sin drives in a wedge between us and God because God is holy. God is beautiful. God is perfect. And therefore, God cannot be in the presence of things that are not good and beautiful and holy. And he said, all I want for you is to live up to the standard that I've set for you. But when we can't live up to that standard, hear what the Bible says, what happens? One, we cannot be in God's presence then. And Isaiah describes it this way. The prophet describes it in Isaiah 59 verse 1 to 2. God speaks through him. And he says, listen, the Lord's arm is not too weak to save you, nor is his ear too deaf to hear your call. God can change your situation. God can turn around something impossible in your life. God can hear your prayers. The problem is not that he cannot do it. Hear what he says, what the problem is. It's your sin that have cut you off from God. Because of your sins, he has turned away and will not listen anymore. A holy God cannot be in the presence of sin, so sin creates a wedge between us. And this world that we're living in wonders, why? I know there's something spiritual. I want to experience it, but why am I cut off from whoever created me? Why am I cut off from the supernatural power? What am I missing? And the Bible is, you're missing your own brokenness and sin. That's what's creating a wedge. God wants to be in your life, but you are creating a wedge between you and God. And that is why the devil wants us to sin, so that that wedge continues growing. But here's the beauty of Christianity that separates it from every other religion in the world. See, every other religion, that's where the story stops. It's like, just try harder. Just do better. And maybe if you get it right, you'll get a little closer. But in Christianity, it's not about how and what we can do. It is about what Jesus has already done for us. God knew if he had to leave it up to us, we will never be in his presence again. So in Colossians 1, verse 21 to 22, we read in the New Testament the following words. You were his enemies, separated from him, from God, by your evil thoughts and actions. So because of your brokenness, you couldn't be in the presence of the Holy God. You became his enemy, not his friend. But it's not the end. Yet God. Those are the best words in the world. Yet God. Despite what we're doing, yet God can do something else. It says, yet now God has reconciled you to himself through the death of Christ in his physical body. As a result, he has brought you into his own presence. It's like, but I can't be in his presence because he's holy and I'm not holy. You are holy and blameless as you stand before him without a single fault. Not because I don't have faults in my life, I have many. Not because I am blameless, not because I am without sin, not because I have no bad thoughts in my life. But because Jesus paid the price for my brokenness. See, the price for sin, the penalty for that was death. According to God. You might believe that's crazy. It's like, I didn't write the rules. The creator of the universe did. That was the penalty. But we couldn't live up to that standard. And the only way for God to get us into his presence again was for Jesus to die, God himself to die in our place. And when Jesus died and when he was resurrected, he created a new path. He built a bridge over all of our brokenness and all of our messiness towards God. The cross of Jesus gives us a relationship with God. The cross of Jesus wipes out all of this confusion about your purpose and about your identity and about the God that's out there somewhere. It wipes all of that out. And it just brings it into perspective in the presence of your Creator and your Savior. And the devil hates that. Our enemy doesn't want you to know God. He doesn't want you to find purpose. He doesn't want you to figure out your true identity. And he wants to destroy that relationship. He wants to create that distance between you and God through getting you to just be in a pattern of sin over and over and over. And at the end of the day, what he really wants to cause is not just broken relationships horizontally and a little bit of a brokenness between you and God. What he actually wants to do is he wants to cause your spiritual death. See, the more sin develops in our mind, the more we think about evil things and toxic things, the more it starts to destroy our lives. Like he did for Amnon. You might be like, Louis, that is crazy. That is why Jesus said, hating your brother is the same as murder. Like, it's not the same. One is killing someone and one is not. Jesus said it's the same thing because it starts in your mind and it grows into your actions. That is why Jesus said looking at a woman and lusting after her is the same as idolatry. But you're like, I didn't sleep with her. Like, I'm okay. Jesus is like, it starts in your mind and it drags you down a path to sin and to complete brokenness. You remember that piece that we read from James in James 1? I want to read to you verse 14 and 15 again. He wrote, temptation comes from our own desires, which entices us and drag us away. And hear this, these desires give birth to sinful actions. And when sin is, not when it's growing, when it is allowed to grow, it gives birth to death. When we allow it free reign in our lives, when we go and we're like, the example that I asked at the beginning, I'm like, just hypnotize him, I'll do whatever. When we just allow the devil to do with us what he wants for sin to grow, it leads to death. And that could be physical death from an overdose, through murder, through whatever that might be. But at the end of the day, it's not just about physical death, it is about eternal death, forever being separated from the one who loves and created you. Spending an eternity in the presence of the evil one, of the devil, and not being in the presence of God. That's what he wants. So stop sin before it grows. Stop toxic thoughts before it grows and leads to death. And how do we do it? I'm so thankful that the Bible never tells us just like stop it. It tells us how. Okay, it says helmet of salvation. What does that mean? Salvation in Jesus gives us a boldness and a confidence that we are truly free. You see, when Jesus died on that cross, he paid for all of our sins in the past, all of them in the present, and all of that in the future. And what the helmet of salvation does is when I truly understand it, when I put that helmet on, because remember, we said this armor is not about having an armor in the closet. It's not saying, I know that there is salvation in Jesus. And then going out and just living as a slave to sin and thoughts. This is about putting it on. It's take the helmet, put the helmet on. So it means like live in the salvation that Jesus has given you. Live with the freedom that he's given you. You are not a slave to your addictions. You're not a slave to the thoughts that pop up in your mind. You have been set free. Whether these are sexual addictions to pornography or to whatever it might be, whether these are addictions to stimulants and alcohol, drugs, whatever it might be, whether this is swearing that you're struggling with, whether it's road rage that you can't get rid of, whether it is anger or criticism or gossiping, you might struggle with it, but you're not a slave to it. It doesn't own you. It doesn't control you. That's what freedom in Jesus means. All of these habits develop from thoughts that we then allow our enemy to control. And finally, if we give him control long enough, we surrender are being to another master, and it ends up in a bad place. You might sit here and like, it's all good for you to say that. But the bad thoughts still pop up. I still have them every now and again. I still look at my wife and I sometimes get angry at her. I still look at a different car and it's flashing his lights at me and I get worked up. I still get frustrated with people at work. What do I do? Like, these thoughts are there. I feel like I'm a slave to them. Here's the thing. We cannot control which thoughts pop up. We can control what we do with our thoughts. Okay, you cannot control the attacks of the enemy on you. They shoot arrows, throw spears the way they want. You can control what you do when you realize you're being attacked. This is where the Bible makes it so clear to us. What happens? We know we've got freedom in Jesus, but these thoughts still pop up. What do I do with them? 2 Corinthians 10 verse 5b, simple verse, so practical. Take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. The thought pops up. You are free. You're not a slave to it. Take it captive. Acknowledge. Realize, I have this. This is not healthy. It's not from God. Take it captive. Make it obedient to Christ. I already have freedom in Christ. So I take the thought captive and I say, this is not what Jesus wants from me. This is not what he wants for me. So I'm going to make it obedient to him. I'm going to replace the devil's lie with the truth. I'm going to replace this evil thought for a thought that is good and beautiful and holy and pure. I'm not going to allow free reign of this. I'm not going to allow someone else to control my thoughts and finally my actions. The beauty of the armor of God is that we don't have to embark on this attack campaign against the enemy. Jesus already defeated the devil. We just need to learn how to stand in his victory. And the armor of God are not these virtuous actions, these perfect things that we start doing, but it is ways to describe the impact that the gospel of Jesus has on our lives when we stand in it. And here's the radical implication that might be hard for you to hear today. This is hard for me to acknowledge. The sin that you are habitually struggling with, that you just can't break with, that you're doing over and over, you're struggling with it because you are allowing it to grow in your mind. You have freedom from it already if you believe in Jesus. That's why he died. And this doesn't mean that we need to be perfect. The Bible is very clear. The only one who's perfect is Jesus. I'm not perfect and I never will be until I'm with Jesus one day. But it does mean that we need to acknowledge that we are at war and that we have to protect our minds and our thoughts against the evil one. And if you don't, Francis Schaeffer, theologian, said these words. He said, the spiritual battle, the loss of victory, is always in the thought world. If we surrender our thoughts, we have lost the spiritual battle. So take those thoughts, take them captive, make them obedient to Christ. And if you're here today and you're not a follower of Jesus yet, then you're like, oh, Louis, I wish I could have that for myself. I wish I can experience that freedom in Christ. It's available to you. But I'm not going to ask you today to just quickly raise your hand and say a prayer and say like, okay, I'm following Jesus. You should do that. You should make a decision to follow him. But following Jesus is more than just a decision we make in the moment. Following Jesus is a journey where every morning and every minute and every afternoon, I make that decision over and over. When a thought comes in that's not from God, I make the decision that I am living in the freedom of Jesus. And I replace the devil's lies with God's truth. So if you are here today and you're like, man, I wish I could have that, come and speak to me or one of our staff members or elders. Send us an email. Or every third Sunday of the month during this service in the boardroom, we've got a class called Step Into Faith. And at that class, we help you. We really try to explain what it means to follow Jesus, what salvation truly means for us in a practical way in our everyday life. So I want to invite you, it's in 2 Sundays' time, step into faith, join us for that. And if you're part of this community, you're not on your own. You don't have to fight these battles on your own. You don't have to figure it out on your own. We will journey with you. But you have to take the step and say, I want to be part of this journey. And we'll help you as much as we can. Let's pray. Jesus, thank you for your cross. For a perfect death and a perfect resurrection that bridged this seemingly impossible gap between us and our God. Thank you, Jesus, that when we know you, that we can stand in a freedom that positions us in front of our Father as His children. I pray today, God, for every person hearing these words who's struggling with their thought world, who feels like they're constantly being bombarded by thoughts that are not from you, that's destroying the relationship with you, that's destroying the relationship with others, that's destroying their spiritual lives. I pray that today that their eyes return to Jesus, that they would see you and the freedom that comes from knowing you. May you give us the strength and the discipline to take every thought that is not from you, to take it captive and to make it obedient to Christ, to replace the lies of the devil with your truth. And may we live in a freedom that we didn't even know was possible. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.